Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the ESL Hearthstone Legendary Series. Once again, I'm T.Joss McCutty Sanders, joined by Greetorp. And we are one game away from determining who's going to be joining us at the Legendary Series Land Finals.
Very excited because, of course, the two guys that have gotten into this final spot are the two guys that I would say I am most familiar with. Of course, they're two of the most famous names in Hearthstone.
Yeah, they were the two invited players for this week. This is the first time out of the 4 weeks of Legendary Series Season 2 where we've seen a final that consisted of both of the players that were invited. And, of course, it is Amaz and Reynad, the owners of Team Archon and Team Templestorm, respectively. We can take a look at the bracket there on your screen. The players, these two finalists rode. We saw Tuwit, Modern Leper, Domnus, and Luigi's battled out for their elimination spots. Amaz took out Tuwit, and Reynad took out Domdus in their semifinals. And now they will meet in the finals, the ultimate showdown of Archon versus Tempestorm. And, of course, the winner does go to the land finals, and the $25,000 prize pool for that land finals would not be possible without our wonderful sponsors. Gigabyte and Plantronics have joined us for Season 2 of the Hearthstone Legendary Series, and they're giving us a lot of cool stuff. Of course, Plantronics has been giving us some of those rig headsets to give away. They're making all the cool stuff that we're able to do, all the awesome Hearthstone matches that we're able to cast possible. So if you want to support those guys, support us, and support Hearthstone Esports, make sure you head on down to those links you just saw and maybe upgrade your hardware, upgrade your headsets.
I think most of all, they brought us all together.
Indeed, yeah.
That's the most important thing.
That is love, the most peace. Important thing.
I mean, what the most unlikely thing possible to have happened. I'm from Las Vegas. You're from San Diego. We're over here casting Amaz and Reynad, who are also here with us, basically. We got you guys at home.
Mm-hmm.
How awesome is that?
It's definitely awesome. So big shout out to those guys.
Also, make sure you're staying in the conversation. I see there's a lot of interactions. Really appreciate you guys. You can go ahead and tweet it at us at ESL Hearthstone and also hashtag the HLS. And we would very, very much appreciate that as, you know, as we said, the interactions are just like a great way of keeping in the conversation and also winning some free packs here and there. That's always nice.
Yeah, you can head to ESL.GG/Legendary Week 4. We're still doing the raffle. Yep. We're giving away packs, and we're also giving away some Plantronics rig headsets. So two very fantastic things. So head on over there for the raffle. But, man, this next matchup is going to be pretty intense. Amaz versus Reynad is, to be honest, I wasn't expecting it. Reynad has played very well over the past couple weeks, but his results haven't shown it. Amaz, on the other hand, has actually had results. He qualified for the World Cyber Arena North American LAN, which will be happening right around the same time as the Legendary Series. I want to list off Amaz's achievements here, because I actually haven't got to
please
do this
do.
Yet.
Please do.
He got top 8 at Viagame Cup number 2, second at the ESL, the Legendary Series Katowice, second at the Viagame 1, second at the DreamHack Viagame Championship, first at the Millennium House Cup number 4, first at IEM Shenzhen.
Oh my god.
Top 4 at DreamHack Bucharest, and of course, top 4 at the Kingwin for Charity Christmas Edition, which happened at the end of 2014. He also has a bunch of accomplishments in smaller tournaments like the old the NESL King of the Hill. He was a multiple-time winner on that and many other smaller cups that he participated in before he got to be more popular.
Man.
So, yeah, that's an impressive rap sheet right there for
and
this guy.
How does Reynad look? Because I know people yesterday got to hear it, but today...
Reynad's aren't quite as good. He also got top 4 at the DreamHack Viagame Championship. They were both there. They... that was one of the first large tournaments for that. Top 8 at Seasaurus Cup number 2. Top 8 at the International Esports Tournament, I believe, IET, which was a tournament that happened in China a couple weeks ago. First at Lord of the Arena 1, and first at Battle of the Best. And, of course, the all-important top 2 in his Showmatch versus Savage in the Cooler Master Series. Top 2 in a
It's hard.
Tournament.
You know, we were talking about how Reynad's achievements haven't really matched the caliber of play in which he really produces out here.
Yeah.
But, you know, law of large numbers, we are expecting great things from Reynad. I mean, he definitely has the capabilities of playing at the very top, as we've seen in the past. Just results aren't coming together. So, I mean, time is going to be the real test, whether or not Reynad could actually win here, whether he can move on to the qualifiers. I mean, that's his ultimate goal. He really wants to prove to be honest, the hater's wrong. And he wants to get some big wins. And I think, you know, he is a little bit burnt out from, I shouldn't say burnt out, but jaded from losing all the time.
Well, I don't know if he's jaded from losing or jaded from just feels burnt out from playing in general.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely like components.
Yeah.
Like they're all components of a larger thing.
Yeah.
You could just tell in his interview that, you know, he has low energy with it. Well, he has lack of confidence for sure. I mean,
Reynad, lack of confidence.
I
good one.
It's true, but I mean, you saw how he almost looked defeated in his interview.
Yeah. He's definitely shown that he wants to focus more on his brand other than his play.
It really makes you question. Anyway, let's get into the game right now because we are with a Handlock versus
this is a Hunter? Tough matchup for the Handlock player.
I would say so.
There's just so much pressure that the mid-range Hunter can put on, and they have so many ways to deal with these big threats. They have silences for the Twilight Drakes, Hunter's Mark for the Mountain Giants. They can build a big board that's really tough to deal with.
Oh.
And then on top of that, they can do burst damage from large amounts of health. Like next turn, Amaz has lethal. So,
what's crazy is that there's still no taunters in here.
Yeah, he does have anti-killbot, which seems to be the play, yeah, but anti-killbot's going to come out, and then Amaz is going to clear it off and then put him back at 14 and set up lethal for the following turn as well, so he'll sort of be in the same position. So Dark Bomb Owl gains him more effective health than I think anti-killbot would in the long run.
All right, passing it on over. I mean, he does have that Mountain Giant, so he kind of... It is Freezing Trap.
Wheezing.
He does kind of want to let the Mountain Giant flourish, because if you're at 8 health and you can put down that Mountain Giant and taunt it up, it's a good position. Also, he's at that critical 6 count where he can potentially put down a Twilight Drake and put down the Mountain Giant and taunt both those up. And if there isn't direct damage, there are things that can be done.
Mm-hmm.
Looks like he puts him down to less than 10, which is... I shouldn't say ideal, but it activates. And still no taunt.
He still has Molten Giant and Anti-Killbot, so he's still going to be in a decent position. He's going to be at 15 health with the Molten Giant on the board, but let's see how much damage can Amaz do next turn. He has 5, 6, 7, 8 from Hero Power.
Mm-hmm. And then Quick Shot is another 3.
He would have Quick Shot for 11, and then Unleash the Hounds for
2
additional. And he would not have enough mana to do that, so most damage he could do would be 5 plus 6, 11 damage.
Brings him down to 4 if he does go for the anti-killbot,
yeah,
which I think he almost certainly has to. I mean, when you go like Dark Bomb or something, you're asking your opponent, do you have 3 damage?
Do you have a kill command?
Do you have a kill command? Do you have a quick shot? Do you have a charger? Of course, he knows he doesn't have a charger because it's not face on.
Yeah.
But still. Whoa!
All right. Well, that's game.
Yep.
All right. Amaz, once again, takes a super quick victory with this mid-range Hunter. He has such a high win rate with this mid-range Hunter over the course of this tournament. I mean, this matchup is pretty one-sided. Mid-range Hunter has such a big... inherent advantage, just because a lot of times Handlock can never stabilize. Because what happens in that matchup is you get to those points where, okay, you play Molten Giant and then you play Healbot. Against other classes, those classes run out of damage. Like if he gets a Paladin, once his True Silver and his Consecrate are gone, he doesn't have any burst.
Yeah.
Hunters never run out of damage.
No, they do.
Especially
not.
Mid-range Hunters. They just don't run, it takes a lot for them to run out of juice.
And I think a lot of times in Constructed, I see that the zombie chows are actually cut a lot of the times, or at least, you know, they go down to 1. So it's not like you have, like, early game to actually start contesting a little bit earlier.
Yeah.
It just makes it so, so much harder. It's just a bad position for Warlock to be in.
That wasn't even that explosive of a start for Amaz.
It could have been a lot worse.
Yeah.
And it's mid-range. It's not even face.
Yeah. So
face is, like, turn 4, you can die.
Yeah.
It's terrible.
Or Mech Shaman. So Amaz still has Druid and his own Handlock to find wins with. So I'd imagine he'll just... if he goes with the same strategy that we've seen a lot of players going in this tournament, saving the Druid for last,
mm-hmm,
then we're probably going to see the Handlock next, which I think Amaz has actually been going for that type of style as well, where he throws out the handlock after his hunter.
I mean, I think it makes the most sense because you're basically giving your druid the most times to get the combo out.
Yeah.
Right? Like, that is a surefire way. You're basically doing anywhere from 14 to 22 damage. So you're asking yourself, can I get my druid to deal 10 damage to my opponent's face or 15 damage to my opponent's face and then have the combo at the same time? And you give yourself three chances. That's putting yourself in a really nice place. So it is going to be handlock versus handlock. I'd love to see like the tiny little differences between the two of them and the two of the handlocks. Because
I know Reynad runs double Shadowflame.
Uh-huh.
He really likes that card. A lot of players have been cutting the second Shadowflame for some, like a bigger threat. But Reynad actually tops out pretty high as well. He runs double Shadowflame, and he also runs Rag. I believe he cuts one Hellfire. So he instead of running two Hellfires, one Shadowflame, or two Hellfires, two Shadowflames, and cutting some of your top end, he keeps his top end, runs double Shadowflame, but cuts one of his Hellfires.
Okay.
Whereas I think Amaz is more standard with double Hellfire, Shadowflame.
Yeah.
And I think Amaz, I can't remember if Amaz had the Zombie Chow or not, had the early game.
I'm not sure either.
But keeping Iron Beak Owl, Mortar Coil, or having Iron Beak Owl, Mortar Coil is a pretty big deal. Just to be able to deal with Twilight Drakes. Super effective way to deal with Twilight Drakes.
Agree. It's a very nice start for presumably Amaz, right, on the bottom?
Yeah. I don't know. Because they both have like, all golden decks.
Yeah, it looks like it's Reynad on bottom. Okay. I'm sorry. It switched.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
So Reynad's on
no,
top.
Yeah, it was Amaz. The webcams match up with their mulligans.
Gotcha. All right, just going to be a couple taps for the beginning stages, nice and quick.
It's a rough hand for Reynad. He has an answer to a Mountain Giant, but he doesn't have an answer to Twilight Drake. Luckily, all Amaz has is Mountain Giant. Mountain Giants are awkward to put out, though, if you're on the coin.
Okay, he does have Twilight Drake here. So he'll be able to Twilight Drake before any of the shenanigans pop down. Ancient Watcher is going to be thrown down as well. He still has the turn for Mountain Giant, which is fine. Do you Mountain Giant here, or do you Twilight Drake here? That's the question. You know, we've talked about this a lot. Mm-hmm. I normally prefer Twilight Drake here. Unfortunately, he has an answer to it with the, as we were talking about. Oh, he's not going to do it right away.
Yeah, because it'll mess up his Mountain Giant timings, yeah.
Yeah, makes sense. Burst it down, take a little bit of initiative. I think these earlier levels, as long as your opponent doesn't snowball out of control, you're still going to be okay. And now is the time to Iron Beak Owl. Go ahead and Mortal Coil. And let's see what we get first. And then probably tap it, tap, tap. No. Okay, explain that to me, because my initial instinct is always to tap there.
Well, then he doesn't really develop the board. He wants to activate that Watcher eventually. And this basically forces Reynad to use the BGH. And also, he wants to set up something that protects whatever his next drop is going to be from whatever Amaz's, or sorry, whatever Reynad's next drop would be. So, eventually, you figure you're going to taunt up the Ancient Watcher anyway.
Okay.
So you might as well do it while you have the curve available. He's happy with his hand right now. He knows that he has plays to make over the next two turns, at least. So he's not in any rush to tap. I know having more options is good.
Yeah. Have we seen Jiraxxus from Reynad, by the way? I almost feel like we haven't.
It's a possibility. Some players do cut Jirax.
I always thought like you need one, either Jiraxxus or Alexstrasza.
Not necessarily. There was a while. Maybe Reynad's afraid of Sacrificial Pact.
It could be.
So there's actually a funny story where Reynad got popular during the time when he was playing a lot of Handlock. His stream started to gain traction. People started to notice him because of his Handlock play. And that was back in the day when Handlock was considered ridiculously strong. And there would be some Handlocks, they would face so many mirrors that they would actually tech in Sacrificial Pact.
I know, man.
To actually counter other Handlocks because they were so rampant on ladder and Jiraxxus was such a staple card. And it was such a swing card in that specific matchup that Sacrificial Pact would actually win you lots of games. I actually fooled around with playing Sacrificial Pact and Zoo Warlock.
For that reason.
For that reason, because there were so many Warlocks in general, Demon Warlocks, Handlocks, Zoo Warlocks, that at worst, I could use Sacrificial Pact to, like, eat an imp from an implosion and heal myself.
Makes sense.
I got rid of it quickly because it was a dead card 99% of the time.
You're like over I'm not up against Warlock. Yeah. Completely useless.
Like, over 20 games, I used it on, like, a flame imp, like, once. Like, that was the best case scenario.
That's hilarious. All right. What do we got? We have seven and two Twilight Drakes. Still have to, like, get through to a lot. We need to also be careful because, obviously, Shadow Flame is something we need to be wary of.
You can't double Toilet Drake here.
Yeah, you cannot double Toilet Drake.
Because that play is just right into Shadow Flame.
That's right. And we get probably, like, some damage to the face. I'm not sure how much, but some damage.
So Twilight Drake, Defender of Argus might be an option. But even that's still pretty susceptible to Shadow Flame here. And running the double Shadow Flame in this matchup is actually gives Reynad the advantage inherently, just because Shadow Flame is so much more useful than Hellfire in the Handlock versus Handlock matchup.
Mm-hmm. Is he going to siphon this out? He was looking like he wants to use Coin Siphon.
Well, he has to do something. Twilight Drake wouldn't be terrible.
Yeah, I don't mind that either. Oh, he's just going to Defender and trade in. Going to maintain his... Oh, no, he gets rid of his Iron Beak. Oh, I thought it was going to maintain it. I was thinking, like, why... What's the difference between keeping it at 9 or 8 health or 6 health? Might as well just trade it out. And keep your Iron Beak Owl alive.
Well, this forces a trade. Because he can't, like, Hellfire Dark Bomb.
No. What to do?
Rag. YOLO Rag.
YOLO Rag. I like it, man.
You know you want to.
You know what? I was a little bit sad when Amaz did that rag and won the 50-50. And he didn't do the typical, like, Amaz, like, yes thing. You know how he, like, interacts with the camera a lot? He was just like, felt good. That's it.
Amaz has aged 10 years since he created Archon.
Apparently.
Also, his personality has aged 10 years as well. That's why he plays so quickly now.
You're telling me he's dead inside.
Yeah.
Okay.
His playful, innocent youth has been stripped away from him.
It's gone.
Same with Reynad.
Well, it is a YOLO rag.
Reynad's just like...
It's not really YOLO.
Reynad's just about 6 months ahead of Amaz on the jaded scale.
Yeah. I mean, look at Amaz's demeanor. It's getting there.
Yeah.
All he has to do is start looking to the right a little bit more. Or our left.
And enable text-to-speech donations. And then he's come full circle. Well, I think you gotta...
Oh, wow.
The double Toilet Drake. Oh, that's actually not too bad. I was thinking, you have to Siphon Soul, but...
It really isn't that bad.
In reality, wherever Rag goes in this situation is not bad. He goes face, activates your Molten Giants.
Yep.
And either way, you still set up a Siphon Soul next turn. If he goes face, you can activate Molten Giants and Siphon Soul in the same turn.
That's pretty ridiculous.
Now... One of the other benefits of running double Shadow Flame is you open up opportunities to be pretty liberal with one of your Shadow Flames by using Sylvanas. Because you're almost always going to get value out of Sylvanas Shadow Flame in the Handlock versus Handlock matchup. And you're nearly always likely to get something really valuable, like a Giant or a Twilight Drake.
So Does Reynad just go for Sylvanas and taunt up?
I think you're sort of... It feels like his only threat, but I think you actually want to save that until it's time to use that combination.
Like, what is the appropriate time?
I wouldn't be surprised if he Sludge Belchers and I mean, he could play just about anything here.
Sure.
Sludge Belcher, and no matter what he does, it's the same outcome.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think there's a point in taunting up. unless you only taunt off your Ancient Watcher, which is what he's going to do. But I think you want to save that Sylvanas until you actually use that Shadow Flame combination.
Okay. Okay.
Rag hits the Twilight Drake, basically silences it, brings it down to one health.
Yep.
Still quite effective. I'd say that was one of the better targets that it could go on.
Does he go for Siphon now?
Well, if he goes for Siphon, so he has no other plays.
The problem with Siphon is that it pulls him farther away from using Molten Giants. And that's one of the big problems, I think, of Siphon. You know, we were talking about yesterday, like, not only does it pull you farther away from using the Molten Giants, but also it's, like, just so clunky. And a lot of the times, like, you know, you just said, like, you're not able to build your board all too easily. That's another big problem. Like, at six, what do you do left with this?
Hellfire coin, Siphon Soul.
Yep. You're right.
Puts him in a pretty good board state here.
20 health. Both of them have those Molten Giants. All right. Well, it's very clear.
Mountain Giant's actually a pretty substantial draw.
Double Mountain Giant, or do we Azure Drake here?
Does he have the second Mountain Giant? Oh, double Giant.
Double Giant.
Okay.
Yeah. We're double Giant here.
And he...
Again, we can activate it so much faster than... Reynad could... Just got yelled at, too, by someone online. They're like, Greater, why are you always saying we? And I just said, I'm very empathic. Or empathetic.
Empathic.
I play Heroes of New Earth. And it's a long story.
Someone out there. That one guy. He's like, yep, I know empathic.
Well... My name's Empath. Whatever, bro. Don't tase me, bro.
That was an awkward turn for him. Not really developing anything, just trying to get himself out of range.
So I feel like he's looking for a Shadow Flame. He has to buy time for the Shadow Flame, right? And this is one of the hard parts about only running one. I've definitely run into this where it's like, oh my gosh, when I'm in this mirror matchup, I just do not have that reverse momentum, really, to take over. And I think Reynad is thinking to himself, geez, do I really want to load up all my giants onto the same board and threaten my opponent like this? Mm-hmm. Because he can, this is what he can do. Load up all of his giants, attack once, bring him down to 18, and just sit. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 cards. It's going to be 8. Wow, he's going for this Shadow Flame. Well, I mean, he has a second Shadow Flame.
Yeah.
He's not going to attack him.
The other option would be have been to do that, but trade the Idle Giant into the Anti-Kill Bot and play the Dark Bomb. But in this situation, especially since you have two Shadow Flames, you want to hold on to Burst. Whoa! Taps into BTH! Wow.
Das gut.
It's something.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's necessarily great.
I mean, it's better than what he had before.
Nah, it's great. Yeah, it's pretty great. Yeah.
Man, you're doing that all the time today.
What?
You're trying to psych me out.
I'm psyching you out. I'm psyching myself out.
I'm on to you, TJ.
That's not that great. Wait. No.
It's the greatest.
It's super great. All right. Well.
It still is tough for Amaz right now because he's bleeding cards.
Yeah, and Reynad has outvalued him.
Yeah.
His big threats have outvalued. Now, Big Game Hunter is usually a big tempo swing. But here, I mean, Reynad still has board control. He can still control the health of Amaz.
He could just load up with another giant, too.
Yeah, I mean, he could clear off this anti-kill bot or clear it off with the giant, attack in with the Twilight Drake, put him at 20, Dark Bomb, play another giant, set himself up for a lethal next turn.
Yep.
And I don't see really any way that Amaz would be able to block that because he doesn't have taunt anymore.
I think Amaz really needs that the Shadow Flame, and he would do like a Sylvanas Shadow Flame.
Yeah.
And be able to steal. Does the Mountain Giant hit? No. Yeah. Dark Bomb attack with the Toilet Drake.
He's going to heal the health back up. Yeah. You want to put him at 20. You don't want to put him at 16. The difference between 20 and 16 is monumental.
I agree.
And now he's looking at lethal next turn.
Hellfire, inconsequential. He has to tap here. Well, what does he tap into? What am I talking about? I think he's just dead here.
He's dead. Except for Protector doesn't help. Oh, he can Sylvanas.
Yeah, he can Sylvanas. No, yeah. No, there's a silence. There's the Iron Beak.
Well, from his perspective, the only way that he could survive is to use Sylvanas and use Sunfury Protector. But that is going to, that's going to do it. So Reynad is going to tie the series up 1-1.
Done like dinner, bro.
Yeah, and he's got, 26 damage total this turn. So 8 damage overkill potential. All right, Reynad, his deck was tailored a little bit better towards the mirror matchup, but very well played by him. He's going to tie up the series 1-1. Still has to win with Druid and Warrior.
That's right. I mean, goes down to a best of 3 now for both these guys. Again, let's go back to the matchups. You just said it. Who has the advantage here? We have one Druid lost. Or, excuse me. No, both of the... What am I trying to say? A Druid one and then a Warlock one.
No, Hunter one.
Hunter, you're right. You're right.
So both players have Druid, and then Reynad has his Grimpatient Warrior, and Amaz has Warlock. So this is actually could be rough for Reynad. He needs to match his Grimpatient Warrior and find a win with that against Druid. So I think that Reynad wants to throw out the Druid in this situation,
just to get rid of it in case he his opponent goes to that.
Yeah. So Reynad. Okay. His strategy so far has been to throw out the Druid last and try and take wins with his other two decks first off. But I think this might be a situation where he actually uses the Druid before he throws out that Patron Warrior, just so he doesn't get to a situation where... where his Grim Patron Warrior has to find a win against Handlock. Because if he throws out Druid, It comes down.
It's tough, man.
At the end of the day, Conquest, you have to find a win with. You have to win with everything.
Yeah.
It's all about mind games. If he thinks that Amaz is going to go Warlock, he should throw out Druid.
So, what do you think for both of these guys? What do you think has the lower percentage to win? Obviously, the Druid versus Druid is mirror matchup. So it's Druid Warlock or Druid Warrior.
Well, and you're saying on paper, Amaz should have the advantage.
Yeah.
Just because Druid versus Druid is 50-50, and Warlock versus Warrior, Amaz has a significant advantage.
Okay.
I don't think Grim Patron Warrior has enough of an advantage over Druid to overcome the advantage that Amaz would have with the Warrior. But it's hard to say because Druid also does well against Handlock.
So if Reynad gets Druid right...
It all depends on the matchup.
He throws out Druid right... No, he's going to throw out Warrior. I was thinking if he throws that Druid right here, he gets actually the most chances, but he might actually just put... No, that's wrong. I'm incorrect about that. He should throw out Warrior.
It doesn't matter. In the end...
It does matter.
He'll have to win a bad matchup regardless.
But at least this time he gets two chances to do it.
Yeah.
There's a chance where he wins with Druid. No, he loses with Druid. There is a way where he wins with Druid, he picks Warrior, and then win. Okay, maybe not.
Nope, because
he would still have to beat the Handlock. You're right.
So the thing about Conquest, where you get to this sort of mind game stage is, eventually you have to win with all three of your decks.
Mm-hmm.
If you throw out Druid in this situation, and he throws out his Handlock, and you beat his Handlock. His Handlock's still on the table. You still have to beat with your Warrior. You just get two chances.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, you're right.
And, I mean, Amaz, there's a lot of players on ladder who are teching in Acidic Swamp Ooze in Handlock.
I have seen that.
Yep.
I have seen that.
I've done it myself as well. I know Dog does it pretty regularly, and Dog has been top 10 legend in NA multiple times this season with Handlock. Actually played against him when he was number 8 legend. And I was number 16, and I beat him, and I didn't get any ranks, which was weird to me. The MMR difference between number 16 and number 15 was so large that beating number 8 didn't get me to number 15.
That's really crazy.
It is pretty crazy. But at the beginning of the season, it's quite wonky. It was like on the 5th, so it was very short window of the season. But there's most of the Handlock players that I've seen have been putting in Acidic Swamp Ooze. which makes the matchup even harder for the Grim Patient Warrior, a matchup that is near impossible already unless you tech in Commanding Shouts as one of your draw mechanics. The only way you do it is if you put so much pressure on early on and then close the game out with, like, Death's Bite and Grom. Or you make a big Grim Patient turn and your opponent does not have Hellfire or Shadowflame. So it's really tough to do.
That's a lot of hoops that you're talking about right there.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we'll find out as we head on out. Now, both... Oh, well. Okay. I was going to say both of the Dark Bombs have been used. There is potential right now. Does he ever go for a Grim Patron here? But you're trying to play around two things, both Shadow Flame and Hellfire right now. And that does not play around it. Just plays into it.
I think that he just probably starts Sludge Belcher here.
Yeah, man, it's just like, it doesn't feel good to do anything aggressive here.
Another way you win in this matchup, if you're the Grim Patient Warrior, is making a huge Frothing Berserker turn. You basically have to have either Whirlwind or Cruel Taskmaster, or sorry, Whirlwind or Unstable Ghoul, and execute to get through the big creature.
Yep.
And then just build the biggest Frothing Berserker that you could possibly imagine.
I would say, like, you need a Thorazin for that, too.
Yeah.
Just to afford everything.
You need to turn that Frothing Berserker into a full-on Drooling Berserker.
Drooling Berserker.
Don't even give the saliva time to froth in his mouth. It just drools out before it even has time to bubble up. Unless he has rabies.
Well...
I'm sorry, it's late.
It's all good, man. I feel it. I love it.
I apologize.
I love it. I think this is a bait. He's basically trying to get Reynad to use as many things to buff up this or to expel as many Grim Patrons as possible, i.e. he wants him to throw down stuff like his Unstable Ghoul, Whirlwinds at this point. Because he's kind of making it like, oh, well, why are you leaving my Grim Patrons up there? Does that mean you don't have AoE? Does that mean you don't have Hellfire? Or
well, this amount of Grim Patrons is not that scary. With no Activator on the board and...
I mean, turn six, you could throw down Activators such as your...
Whirlwind?
Yes.
That's pretty much it.
Well, you could also throw down... what's her name? The
you
Charger.
You can Warsong Commander and Unstable Ghoul. But that's overextending. And,
yeah.
I mean, I don't think he's going to overextend too much into this. At the end of this turn, he's going to be left with just two Grim Patrons. Because I'm sure that he's going to trade one of these into the Ancient Watcher just to protect himself against Shadowflame.
Okay.
He's going to gain lots of armor, though.
Let's find out. Yep, you're right.
There still is a second Ancient Watcher plus a Shadowflame in the hand.
Is that to be played right now? Do we ooze? Ooze...
I don't think you can ooze and then Shadow Flame the ooze.
And then coin out a Mortal Coil. I don't love that.
Ah! You turn the coin into a card, effectively.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure how... Yeah.
You can always kill the Armorsmith, though. There's no need to actually push... could be like an Acolyte of Pain inside your hand. And then, like, he uses his Death Rattle. I'm sorry. The Death Rattle will kill the... You don't need to coin. Because the Acidic Swamp Ooze is going to proc the Death Rattle for the weapon.
Oh, yeah. The only problem with the Ooze here is that you don't have it later on in the game where it might be a little bit more crucial.
That's true.
And this cleans it off just as clearly. You actually don't give the... Well, that's actually pretty good that he cleared that. You don't give the warrior quite as much armor as well.
Uh-huh.
Since it actually would have been, five extra armor? Because it would have been two more Grim Patrons spawn, plus the damage from Shadow Flame, so he would have gained three from the Death Bite. He would have gained eight total, which is a lot of
that
armor.
That is a lot of armor.
And not that it matters, because most of the time, the Handlock doesn't win by, like, bursting down. They win by just getting overwhelming control over the board, and then eventually killing you over a couple turns anyway.
Yep.
So.
All right, he's just going to armor up after playing the Unstable Ghoul and the Frothing Berserker.
Ooh, he's got Warsong Commander and Grim Patron next turn combined with the Deathbite. So how much damage is this? Okay, let's calculate. So if no taunt is played, he could 4 damage from the Deathbite.
Yep.
6 damage from the Grim Patrons.
At least if there's a...
I'm saying if nothing's played in the board.
Okay.
Oh, it doesn't matter anymore.
There it goes.
Stop the calculations!
That's still a scary Frothing Berserker.
Not too much. Oh, well, second Deathbite comes right on time here.
Cannot complain with that. Well, what is our turn? we're 1 mana away from it being beautiful, right?
Oh, okay. Warsong Commander, Grim Patron.
Okay.
Throw the Frothing Berserker into the Sludge Belcher.
Yep.
And then Grim Patron into the Sludge. Unstable Ghoul into the Acidic Swamp Ooze. Then you'll have 4 Grim Patrons and nothing else on the board except for a 2 health Warsong Commander. It seems reasonable. The other way would be to develop the Deathbite here and clear everything off the board except for a 1. You'd have a 1 health Frothing Berserker.
Yeah.
And a 1.
You could also keep the Frothing Berserker. Go for the trade into with the ghoul. Yeah, like this. Trade the ghoul. You have that. Sack both of the... Well, 1 of the Grim Patrons in.
Yeah, that's true.
With the remaining Grim Patron, you're getting another one. Mm-hmm. I think that's what he's going to do. And
that's
a lot of damage.
That's not lethal, is it?
No.
That's not. 14. It's going to be 16.
Oh, my God.
17, 18, 19.
Was he able to play this?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, the Spectator Client is a little bit later. Okay.
Yeah. The animation just didn't finish, he did finish his turn.
Oh, he didn't get his last attack.
Oh, the Hellfire off the top!
No!
Oh, my goodness gracious.
Oh, my gosh.
That's heartbreaking.
Well. Oh.
That's right. Reynad gives us a slight smile. But, I mean, Hemlock's out of cards.
Yeah.
And you can Deathbite this down here. Throw down Sludge Belcher next turn, set up for a pretty good turn with Battle Rage.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true. Go for face.
Yeah.
And we're looking for Grommash. Oh, wow. Is that good? Do you need to do that right now? I think that might be the only play right now. The other option is to Twilight Drake, send for your protector. But, okay, let's just think.
No matter what you do, you're dead to Grom.
Yeah.
Because even if you Twilight Drake and send for your protector here, the Deathbite goes into the Twilight Drake and kills it, because the most health it could be would be 5. The Sludge Belcher goes into the Antique Killbot.
So I think
then
we have to Draxus then.
Yeah, and so Draxus gives you the best state right now. There's less things that kill you from hand. This would be pretty great if Reynad wins this, because this would be going into a rough matchup, having Druid as his only card left.
Let's find out.
Slam. Wow.
That is the least useful card and the big problem.
So he's going to go for the Battle Rage play regardless, just because
this is
the only way he gets two draws out of this.
Oh, that's so brutal. We know that there's going to be a Twilight Jake tap, and Sunfury Protector at the very least. So he's going to have a 4-3 and a 6-6 taunted up.
Still called a tap when he's Draxus?
Oh, that's true.
I guess you're tapping the button.
You are tapping the button.
You're tapping that Infernal.
Mortal Coil. Not going to play the Mountain Giant.
No.
And he's going to... Oh, it's a 4-4. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry, I forgot the card draw.
And I don't know if Reynad's ever going to be able to get through this.
Okay, so he needs to slam, get an execute.
Slam into execute, and then...
And then...
Oh, he can clear it off with a cruel taskmaster. Yeah.
Yeah, but... Well, he still needs to slam. Slam the big guy.
Yeah, to be honest, slamming the Twilight Drake might be better.
Really?
Because what if you don't get an execute? Oh, no, you can...
You can still hero power. Yeah, or not hero power.
You can still cruel taskmaster and axe it.
Correct.
But to be honest, I'd slam the Twilight Drake, because most of the cards that you're going to get... would be better off for you slamming the Twilight Drake, because you can clear the Twilight Drake off right now without having to use any other cards. But you can still clear this off.
Yep.
So.
I think either or. Oh, yeah. Well timed. That was not serious. That was the opposite of it.
Yeah.
I was using sarcasm.
Well, I
for
mean,
the interwebs out
the
there.
Thorsand is not going to be that great of a
card.
It's not going to get much value out of the effect.
Well, the whirlwind becomes zero.
But it's, yeah. But it's still a body.
It is. It is.
Whoa.
Wrong way. That would have been a mistake.
The one thing that Reynad does have going for him is that Amaz has lost his card engine. He's lost his tap.
Yeah, that's true.
He's going to get a 6-6 every turn, but he's not going to get any additional cards. So,
and there's still 25 life, so we're looking at, like, the two turns.
And he still has two executes somewhere in his deck.
Yeah. And Dr. Boom. Interesting spot. I think we boom boom hero power here. I think that's like...
All right, so how do you go about clearing the board, though? You want to get rid of this Thorsand because it represents a pretty big threat with being 5 damage. So you throw the Twilight Drake and the... Oh, man. Do you keep the taunt preserved? No, because an execute just kills you.
Execute, a whirlwind, cruel taskmaster.
So you throw the Twilight Drake and the Sunfury Protector into the Emperor Thorsand. Use your weapon to kill the cruel taskmaster.
Okay.
You'll be at 5 health with a 3 damage.
I know. Not looking
so good. So either you die to execute. Either way, you die to Grom, but attacking him with your Twilight Drake to the Emperor Thorsand means you don't die to execute.
Correct.
So.
Oh my god. It hurts. Okay, he's not doing that. How is he doing this?
Oh, this way he still doesn't die to execute.
Yeah.
He still only dies to Grom.
2 whirlwinds.
That doesn't do him any good.
No.
Can Whirlwind. Axe. Put him at 2.
2. And the Boombots are going to kill the Thorsand. You know that, right?
Oh, is he going to die?
No, it's not.
1.
It's not.
2. He can't take that 4 damage, actually.
That was scary.
There's 16 damage.
16, yeah.
He has to kill it with the...
Oh, my God. And he's looking for the Grommash.
Yeah. He's dead no matter what.
Yeah.
That's game.
Because of Hellfire, right?
Yeah.
7,
he can't,
6, 13,
he can't
16,
even force a draw
19.
Because if he axes and puts him at 2, he dies to just what's on board plus the weapon. Because that would be...
Oh, the humanity.
Yeah. That's rough. There was so many draws there that would put him in a better board state. Would have been execute or even like Battle Rage to draw into something else.
Attacked in. Praise. Hopefully he doesn't die. Unfortunately, we know.
13, 16, 19, exact lethal for Amaz.
That's been happening a lot today.
Yeah, exact lethal. Yeah.
Well, you never know. He could Mountain Giant here. Not calculating.
Yeah. Doubtful. All right. Amaz takes a 2-1 lead in the series. Amaz is 1-1 away from making it to the Legendary Series Season 2 LAN Finals. He just has to find a win with Druid.
We were talking about that before. It is a lot of times very easy to find a win with that. You know, there's a very easy win condition, which is, of course, the combo. And when you have 2 chances to get that combo down, magic can happen.
It can.
Miracles can happen.
Yeah.
And miracles. I've already sang it yesterday that I believe in miracles.
You want to sing it again?
I believe in miracles.
Nice.
And then you go.
Nope. That's it.
All right.
It's all you just leaving me out there to dry.
You're a terrible co-caster.
I know.
You know, I did the, hey, everyone, and then you didn't say get in here. And then I do the I believe in miracles, and you don't call me a sexy thing. You know, sometimes I don't feel appreciated. Let's move on.
Just wipe the screen. All right. Well, Druid versus Druid is going to be the next matchup. Reynad still has to find a win with Druid and Patron Warrior. And Amaz just has to find a win with Druid one of these games.
Okay, let's talk about statistics real quick.
Let's do
50%, just assuming. Amaz has a 75% chance of winning overall. If he has a 50% both times.
Yeah, which is very close. He has very close to 50%. It's 50% for the mirror matchup and very close to 50% for Grim Patriot.
So there's a 75%, assuming you just put those percentages in, you know, you get, I mean, it's flipping a coin and hoping that heads shows up one at a time, right?
Yeah.
So it's actually a 75% chance that that happens.
Yeah. But we've seen stranger things happen, and Reynad has been playing pretty well so far.
Yes.
He missed lethal one time earlier today, but he still ended up winning that match. And in the grand scheme of things, it really didn't matter. And other than that, it seems like he's on top of his game here. And so we are going to move into the Druid versus Druid mirror matchup. This is game number four of the final series of the final regular season week.
Match point,
of
baby.
Legendary Series Season 2.
And the last thing Reynad wants in this spot, of the last two invited, he doesn't want to be top two. Okay? He has enough top twos in his life.
He has enough top twos, and also, for the Legendary Series, you get nothing.
Nothing.
First, second place is the same as eighth place.
And eighth place, you didn't have to waste nearly as much time.
Indeed.
So it would behoove him to start crushing face, taking names, slaying dragons, etc.
Well, we've seen this powerful start from Reynad be successful. In the past, with the Innervate Shade, he actually won his final game against Domdus with that exact start.
Yep.
But having a turn to Hero Power as the follow-up is not quite as strong.
No. I would say it would be less than strong. It would be weak.
Yeah.
There's my commentary for today. Thank you. Still, he has a plethora of turn four plays. We did see Reynad last time actually start activating a shade as soon as he hit 5/5.
Yeah.
We'll find out if that happens again. Shredder will pop out here. The nice turn three play. I should have said turn four. I meant turn three. You guys know.
Against Druid, you can actually activate this on turn four because what you do is you force your opponent into an awkward situation where
you want to swipe. Go ahead. I still have a mini up on the
board. And it makes them flow to mana. Like, this turn is actually super awkward because you either use... Oh, he's just going to throw out the BGH. It's just going to get keepered.
Is that in preparation for a boom? Like, what is he doing for turn 7?
Yeah. It's in preparation for a boom. I mean, this other play that turn would just be to silence the Pallid Shredder, which we're just trade into anyway.
Wow, unreal right now.
Yeah.
Unreal position.
So much pressure being put on by Reynad here. And if you play Dr. Boom, you're looking at... You're staring at 12 damage. You're staring at Savage War lethal next turn if you play Dr. Boom. That would be exact lethal with Savage War plus Hero Power. Because it'd be 10, 12 damage on board, plus 8 damage from the Savage War.
Yep.
Plus 1 damage from the Hero Power. So that would be exactly 21. So Amaz is thinking, if I don't clear something off this board right now, I'm dead. I could be dead. It's...
All right. No Millhouse Mana Storm.
That's Come on, Doomsayer. Snowchugger. That's terrible. he does get to silence the shade, though, which is actually a pretty big deal. In the
it saves him 3 health. Mm-hmm. That's sure. 5 drop. Throws down a Belcher. I mean, man, Reynad has been, other than that turn two, everything's looked beautiful so far.
Yeah.
He's been able to, you know, command board presence. And as you were saying, like this Druid, it's just about having that first initial tempo, being able to take that board presence, that board control, and then from there, setting up your combos. Like if this Savage Roar was instead on Reynad's side, game would be over next turn.
It's possible. It still might be over next turn.
Yeah, definitely so.
Yeah. So he's got to try and remove as many bodies off the board as he possibly can here.
And he is going to go for that swipe.
I think you take out the snow choker. No, he takes out... I don't know. Kind of would like to see them take out the snow choker. But I guess it's pretty inconsequential there.
Are we charging here?
No.
we're still just...
Well, no, I think you still put out the Sludge Belcher.
Okay.
You want that Druid of the Claw is a lot more flexible than the Sludge Belcher.
Because we still have, like, turn 8, Druid of the Claw, yeah. And then Savage Roar.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
I mean, it is a possibility, but you leave all your creatures on the board have 2 health. It leaves your opponent with an almost perfect Force of Nature clear if you charge into this.
True.
If you charge into this Keeper of the Grove. And also, like I said, Druid of the Claw is more flexible. Sludge Belcher here, very reasonable.
That is not what Amaz wanted to see right there. Shadow Nax does absolutely nothing, and he can't. Does he Savage Roar here?
No. Well, that's gonna be it.
JJ.
That is indeed JJ. All right. Well, that was a very quick game. Reminiscent of that first one.
Oh,
there.
Look at that for good measure.
Yeah, multiple ways for him to be able to close this one out. Druid of the Claw, Charge Mode, or Force of Nature. Both end the game, and Reynad with an explosive start with that Innervate Shade. Amaz just never had an opportunity to catch up, and we're going to a game 5.
That's right, man. And the tides are turning.
Yeah.
The tides are turning for sure. 2-2. It's going to be that Druid versus the Warrior. Mm-hmm. And as you said, it's definitely an interesting spot because... Well... Okay, the Warrior has a lot of capabilities of bursting down the Druid at multiple points in time, right?
Yeah.
Like, they definitely have a lot of tempo. They can kind of kill Druid before that Savage Roar combo actually starts to exist. We kind of saw that. It was super close that... it was super close. I forgot which match it was from before. But in general, I know you were saying... Wait, were you saying that Druid has the advantage here?
Patient Warrior has the advantage.
Patron Hit Warrior. Oh, it was against the regular Warrior.
Control Warrior, yeah.
Control Warrior, yeah. Okay. So, definitely not looking super great right now for Amaz.
No. But, I mean, this matchup is actually relatively...
You said
it's close.
50-50, right?
I think it's more in favor of the Patron Warrior.
By how much?
I don't know. Somewhere between 55 and 65, probably.
Okay.
But most of that's just from personal experience. Because Patron Warrior, even though a lot of pros have been experimenting with it, there's been a lot of people who have tried it out quite a bit. There's still not enough sample sizes to really say which one has the advantage. The one thing is that once a Grim Patron Warrior gets out Grim Patrons against a Druid, it's really hard for a Druid to deal with them.
Do you think Grim Patron Warrior still is being honed and... you know, innovated, because, you know, we have seen it change and change and change.
Yeah.
As time has gone on.
It's still being refined. And it's also, a lot of the choices that you make with Grim Patron Warrior are meta-dependent.
Okay. Understandable.
If the meta starts going heavy control, then cards like Commanding Shout get a lot more value. If it starts to go heavy aggro, cards like Unstable Ghoul get a lot more value.
Sure.
Then there's the argument of, in the mid-game, do you play cards like... Dread Corsair, which are big tempo gainers, or do you play cards like Piloted Shredder, which help you focus on having more pressure or heavier board control early on? So there's a lot of tech choices that you could make that really improve your matchup against some things. Commanding Shout, the big one, improving your matchup against like Handlock and Control Warrior, or cards like Unstable Ghoul, which improve your matchup against like Zoo and Face Hunter. Or Piloted Shredder, which improve your matchup against Control Warrior and possibly Druids. So there's a lot of different cards that you can make, but they're mostly meta-dependent. I think the refinement of the deck is still...
Is that like 100% or close to 100%, you think?
No.
No? Like 90?
I don't think there's many decks that are close to 100%.
Yeah.
Control Warrior is probably the closest.
Yeah.
Because it's the one that fluctuates the least. Handlock is very close, but also has meta-dependent choices. Midrange Druid's also very close. But I still think Grim Patron Warrior has a lot of room to grow.
Gotcha. Very interesting, man. I just love watching the development of these decks because, you know, when it first bursted onto the field, I saw that Reddit thread and I was like, wow, this looks really cool. I really want to try this. And it was just so much fun to play with. And when I see things like Gnomish Inventor and the Dread Corsair, at first I was like, what the heck is that doing in there? And then I realized, like, oh, it makes sense. You need card draw. It gets a lot of tempo. It just feels really cool. And it's really interesting to see, like, these older cards. Like, Dread Corsair, everybody's like, that's a trash card. Yeah. You don't get that in Arena at all, ever. Well, I shouldn't say ever. Sometimes you will get it. But, like, ordinarily, you're not looking to pick that up and draft it.
Yeah.
And it's really cool to see these obsolete cards actually come into spotlight.
Yeah.
Once these newer cards really start to let the game flourish, you know? Hearthstone's able to let their hair down a little bit. It's not braided or bunned up. They don't need to do that anymore.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Let it fly, Hearthstone.
No, it's... Okay. I was going to sing again. I don't want to sing. I'm done singing for you. Do you know why? Because you're not going to pick it up.
It depends on the song.
It does depend on the song.
All right, so this is actually super bad of a position for Reynad because Innervate Thorsen is so hard to deal with. You have a Shade on the board. Amaz actually reduced the cost of 2 pieces of the combo. You can combo on turn 7. The one thing he does going for him is that he's going to be able to get out Grim Patriot super early, especially since next turn he's got Deathbite, the charge, plus Grim Patriot Coin Whirlwind.
Yep.
But is he going to be able to live?
Oh, man. Perfectly timed swipe there. I mean, he had 2 swipes, 2 wraths. Could have easily dealt with that in different ways. Still, having patrons down here is going to be good. Is going to be good.
4 patrons!
4 patrons, man.
And he's got Warsong Commander to follow it up the next turn. Yeah, and this is one of those positions. Once a warrior gets Grim Patrons down against a druid, it's hard for them to be able to deal with it. I mean, they have to deal with them one by one. They have to, like, Hero Power one, Keeper the other, Wrath the other. But if they can't do all of that, then it's just super tough for them.
3, 6, 12. So I'm thinking to myself, if I'm druid in this spot, do I just heal?
No. I think you can just Sludge Belcher, Hero Power 1 down, kill another with the Shade.
Do you really want to kill another with the Shade? Like, does it...
I think so. Those are dangerous, man.
You have... let me think. 7. Okay, you don't have Lethal next turn.
Those are angry dwarves with shiny axes.
I was thinking... I thought for sure that he had Lethal next turn.
You gotta kill
but
as
it's
many
only
going to
be...
Can.
How much is it going to be? 22? 8 plus 14. Yeah, he's 22. He's 1 away from lethal next turn with this shade.
Mm-hmm.
That hurts my soul.
Yeah. And if you just Sludge Belcher and your opponent has something like a Cruel Taskmaster, all of a sudden you're just really screwed.
All right, Force of Nature pops out here. Oh, now he does have lethal next turn.
Okay.
Now he does. I like that play a lot, man.
Yeah. But I mean, Reynad
it's very unsuspecting.
Just has double Sludge Belcher, man.
That's true.
Like, and then he's got Armorsmith and Warsong Commander.
Oh my god, this thing's spiraling out of control so quickly.
So Reynad, he needs the Sludge Belcher here. That's pretty much a given. There's no other play that really makes sense.
Yeah,
and he's starting to put on the pressure himself. He's put Amaz at 13 health.
Okay.
So, Amaz's only real option here is to use Sludge Belcher himself, but that's super risky. I mean, it's the least risky play out of all of them.
Sure.
He can Ancient of Lore and
heal?
Try
no.
to...
If he heals, he's most likely... okay, so he heals for 5. He's to 18. He has 9 left.
Heal is such a like a beta play, though.
Yeah, I'm very clearly pigeonholing into this combo, man. I'm very clearly just pigeonholing into this combo.
Welcome to the world of Druid.
Okay.
It's very one-dimensional. It's a very one-dimensional deck.
I just want this combo to work.
Yeah, don't we all? But in reality, I mean, Amaz seemed like he was in a good position. Reynad seemed like he was in a good position. Amaz sort of questioned it a little bit with threatening combo. But Sludge Belcher is actually sort of a tech card as well. And he actually does heal.
Beta, baby. Hey, what's up?
That's a big
what's
deal.
Up?
Oh, okay. This is a big turn.
I'm making the same plays that...
All right.
So I don't know what to do here, man.
He can't preserve his Grim Patrons.
He has to trade him out?
Yeah, he has to trade him out.
So you trade him out. You take your...
And to be honest, I think he has to Dr.
Armorsmith Sludge Belcher here, or do you Dr. Boom?
I think you just trade him out and then Dr. Boom.
Okay.
Does he play... Yeah, Sludge Belcher's, like, so hard to get through with a combo.
Yes.
Just because you have to get through both iterations, and it's hard to spread the damage. So Shade the next turn will actually be 9 damage. So he would only need to piece together... he'd be at 21 health. He would only need to piece together 13 damage. But there was no way that he could spread apart the damage enough to do 13 with just the force of nature.
Or 12?
12. Math!
I got you. Bro.
12, no, but there'd be no way for him to piece together 12 damage.
Fiery War Axe.
Yep, this is...
And he's just going to push for damage. Wow! This is crazy, man. This is insane.
All right, so we're going to see combo here to clear.
Oh, wow. Chow is not going to help. Yep.
Can he live? Force of Nature, Savage Roar. He could weave in a hero power. He could clear off.
How does he weave in a hero power?
Well,
Force of Nature is 5.
Oh, no, just
Savage
kidding.
Is 2.
So if you Force of Nature...
3 fours, his 2. This hero power does 3 attack already. And this is regardless of the Warsong plus Armorsmith, right? Like, we're not even going to count that in.
He's because dead.
Yeah. I think he's 100% dead. Even if he clears this board, how does he deal with...
So let's spread this damage.
Okay.
Ancient of Lorne Shade would both go into Sludge Belchers. His face would go into one slime. One of the treants would go into another.
The other slime.
And the
patron,
other two,
patron.
Yeah. No, so he'd be alive. He'd be alive.
No, he 5 health.
He'd be at 5 health with 2 damage on the board.
You're right.
Oh, no. He'd be 5 health with... No, he is dead. No, he's not dead. So there's so many draws that win the game. Frothing Berserker.
Anything
cruel
that deals
Taskmaster,
1 damage right now.
Anything.
Boom. Done.
That's it.
That's it.
That's it.
It's perfect amount
he
of mana, too.
He charges the face.
Anything... Oh my god.
Charges the face with an Acolyte of Pain.
That's what you needed to win.
To win the game.
An Acolyte of Pain.
And how many times does Acolyte of Pain calculate into lethal
and look,
damage?
And look, Reynad's so happy he's smiling right now.
He looks ecstatic.
No, really cool, obviously. That was super, super close. What a fun... This is what I'm talking about, man. Grim Patron is so much fun to play with. So much fun to watch. It's really one of my favorite decks that could have popped out into Hearthstone. I mean, I really felt like the beginning of Hearthstone, it was okay, but now it's really starting to turn up with Blackrock Mountain. It's really, really cool. Obviously, with Thorzin, it's super cool with all of the control decks that have come up, and I think it's just been a lot of fun, man.
Yeah. So that locks in the fourth player that's made it through the Legendary Series weeks that's going to be joining us at that Season 2 Legendary Series LAN Finals. We have Kalento, Life Coach, Kabi, and Reynad are going to be the 4 players that qualify for that LAN Finals. Now, Amaz, he will have another chance. We didn't want to talk about the Redemption Tournament that will be happening later this week, May 14th, 15th, 16th, and 17th. There's going to be a lot of players. Every single player, all 28 of them, that played in those Legendary Series weeks. So, I mean, there's players like Strifecrow.
It actually might be 27, actually. Because
it's 26. It's 26 separate players, but 28 seeded because Lead Paint and Tuet will get seeded into 2 separate brackets.
Twice, yeah.
And so we'll take 4 players from there plus 8 players from that last chance qualifier. So, I mean, we're getting set up for a really exciting LAN Finals.
Yeah, I think, you know, the games have been super fun. Also, I mean, the fact that anybody can actually go into this, you can go from the Challenger Cup, which actually are completely done now, but you can also go from that last chance open, as you were talking about. I think that's really important for you guys out there. Even if you don't think you're going to win, just go and get some experience. Just try it out. Feel other people's decks. See what the meta is. It's just a lot of fun. It's a great way to engage in the community, and if Ellie Goulding told me anything, it's that anything can happen.
Ellie Goulding just teaches me so many life lessons.
She does.
Yeah. To turn the lights
Alicia
down.
Alicia Keys told me that I was on fire, but she got the words mixed up. That's okay.
Yeah. She meant Andre instead of girl.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's a common mistake.
Yeah, I mean, it happens all the time.
Definitely a common mistake. But yeah, of course, that last chance qualifier, we talked about a little bit, but Last chance qualifier. The final eight spots of Legendary Series LAN Finals will be open to North American players that want to participate in that qualifier. So you can head over to legendaryseries.com to get more information on that. We say it's only open to North American players because that actually happens a week before the LAN Finals and determines the final eight spots. So players outside of North America will not have ample time to get visas in order to come here. So unfortunately, the last week's Challenger Cup was your last opportunity if you were in EU. But $25,000, of course, on the line for those players. I mean, the Redemption Tournament as well. Strifecrow, Kaldi, Amaz. So many players, so many big-name players that we've seen over the past couple weeks, over the 4 weeks of the Legendary Series that have that didn't make it through, that we'll still get to see again in the Redemption Tournament later this week.
It's going to be a lot of fun, man. Really, really cool. Again, I told you multiple times that I wish I could participate in it because I feel like I could do it, bro. I could do it. With your tutelage, I could do anything, TJ. But unfortunately, we are going to be cut from that. We can't do it at all. But if you guys want to keep up with all the interaction also and also keep up with future tournaments that are going to be popping up because, you know, ESL has been very proactive with keeping up with Hearthstone, be sure to follow us over on Twitter, twitter.com/ESL Hearthstone. Of course, hashtag HLS to stay in the conversation right now. But it's a good place to, I think, just like start your career if you want to get into competitive sports, because I know a lot of people out there, they are playing Hearthstone not only to have fun, but also to be a little bit more competitive and try their luck at what they can do.
All righty. Well, we actually do have an interview ready with our winner of today's tournament, Reynad, who will be joining us at the LAN Finals. Hey, Andre, can you hear me?
Oh, yeah, I can, TJ.
Hey, first off, congratulations. It was a very impressive victory. Second off, I just want to ask you about your deck choices. Your own sort of your manager of your brand criticized your deck choices. He said you've been playing really well lately, but it's been your deck choices that has been your downfall in your tournaments. What would you say went into your deck choices for this? It was Grimpage Warrior, the Handlock, and of course the Druid. Why'd you pick those?
They were the decks that were like most unanimously like good among other pro players, and for this tournament, for once I tried to like have a lot of self-control and not put my own spin on anything. Like, I literally, if I built my own Patron Warrior, granted I've played like five games of the deck in my life, I would have changed like 10 cards or something, but instead I just copied Just Saiyans because his list is just like probably better because he's just better at the deck than me. So I did that, and then for Handlock, it's like I was the best Handlock player back when the deck was good, but I haven't touched it in months, so I didn't know what list was good. So I made my own weird list that was like 10 cards different, and in the end, I just like net deck Nyreas, because he's rank 2 or something in Europe, or was at the time. And then for Druid, that one, okay, that list confused me, because like two days ago on stream, that's like the one deck I did in that deck. 2 days ago on stream, I was trying Dragon Druid and like more of a ramp shell with Ancient of Wars. And I was like, wow, you know, big taunts are pretty good against these patron decks that only have 2 execute. So I really wanted to, I kept playing more games of the Dragon Druid deck and it was good, but I kept like wanting combo and matchups and I wanted to be more aggressive and stuff. So in the end, I just like took a normal Druid shell, played Sludge Belchers instead of Azur Drakes, and then played Wars in like a normal Druid shell. And I like talked through my thought process on stream as I was building this deck. It was like an independent thought of mine, and I built it on stream and I'm like, wow, that fixes so many matchups. It's even really good against Zoo. So I brought the deck to this tournament thinking like that was the deck I was least sure about because that was, to my knowledge, my own deck. But then there's like 3 people in the tournament playing it. Like Amaz had Wars and his Fast Druid. One of the guys I played in the group yesterday had it too. So it was really confusing to me that like everyone had it.
Yeah.
You know?
It was Tuet was the other player that had Wars in his.
Right.
Yeah.
So maybe they're watching the stream. Maybe they just came up with it independently. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it seems like it's. Yeah.
Well, it all seemed to work out for you.
With this win, do you think it's enough for a paradigm shift in how you're viewing like the future for yourself?
No. Every time people talk about competitive Hearthstone, they want to say like how skill intensive it is, and then the people who are like very in the camp of the game is like very skill intensive, and there's these great players that beat variants. They always use players like Kalento as an example, you know, just ignoring like the 10 tournaments in a row that he has a rough patch for. But I want this to be like the counterpoint. The game is all RNG. I had no practice. That was like the first time I played Patron Warrior in my life. I made a ton of mistakes. I missed lethal like twice in the tournament. And, you know, it's esports. I mean, that's the thing. In Hearthstone, it's like, as long as your decks don't suck and you're not playing like terribly, you have pretty much the same chance as anyone else. But I mean, if there's a guy that's putting like 12 hours in analyzing matchups, he's a lot more likely to pick the right decks for a tournament. I also think like Amaz was favored matchup-wise in the last set because he had mid-range Hunter, and then for game, the second to last game, I also mispicked. I tried to like next level him, thinking he might pick Druid, but you know, it doesn't matter.
Your intention is to stay on as a coach then? Or to I guess move focus more towards.
I'm not a coach. I mean, I'm a player more than anything. It's just like people don't see the difference between managing like a few Hearthstone players and managing like a full Counter-Strike team that's having a roster change every week, and like sure. a Heroes team with like a gaming house. And it's like every 2 hours, you know, I get a call about something I have to do. So I just don't have time to like play Hearthstone 10 hours a day and completely commit to being like a full-time pro player. And that's not really my goal, because big picture, you know, a year from now, no one's going to remember who won this week in Legendary Series. No one cares. But, you know, Tempest Storm will hopefully still be around, still be a strong brand. So, you know, if I ever need to make a choice between committing time to preparing for a tournament or taking care of team stuff, you know, team stuff's always going to win out. But, yeah, I don't know. I think it was a cool tournament, and I'll continue to play. Like I said, because my chances don't decrease that much by just not practicing, so I'll continue to play the big tournaments. You know, stuff like DreamHack, really fun to play for me. I tried casting like DreamHack Bucharest. I mean, the camera came back to us in the middle of the cast one time, and I was literally asleep in my chair. like Nimsh had to wake me up. I just get so, I don't know. I care very little about my own matches, so it's like, other people's matches are like even less interesting a lot of the time, especially when you cast for 8 hours. But I do enjoy casting for like certain amounts of time. I don't know. Point is, I'll be a player for the big tournaments. You know, they're still fun to play as long as you're winning. But yeah, the little stuff I'm gonna start passing up on.
The Red Bull, you said, was the key to your casting success.
It was. Man, I get really excited. I just never drink it, right? So like when I do take Red Bull, it's insane what it does. For that Aces thing where they had to stay awake for 24 hours, I drank like maybe like 7 Red Bulls towards the end, and then I ended up being awake for like 35 hours. Like went home, took care of like 6 hours of work, and then I slept. That stuff's insane.
All right. Well, we definitely look forward to seeing you at the Legendary Series. I'm sure you would have been there anyway. It's not really that far away from you. So
can ESL comp me for the 45-minute drive worth of gas?
No, because I'll just pick you up on my way there, so ESL doesn't have to pay a dime. But do you have any shout outs? You want to give me a shout out to your sponsors, to your fans, or anything?
Yeah, of course. Shout out to G2A, Funk, Namecheap, and Twitch, of course, sponsoring the team. They're hugely supportive. They're the guys that let us, you know, expand into all the teams that we're expanding into. And yeah, shout out to Gara for giving me a lot of good advice beforehand, and just like linking a bunch of decks for me to choose from. That's like where I found Nyria's list and stuff. A shout out to Just Saying, I guess, for the Patron deck. If I can win with it, anyone can. And yeah, shout out to Hyped, of course, just, you know, and Rasma, new Tempo Storm Hearthstone player. And yeah, I mean, all our players, Counter-Strike, Heroes, these guys have been. There's even though it's not like the game they play, a lot of times they're here watching the tournaments, being supportive, and all the Tempest Storm staff as well. It's like a group of like a dozen people that are just, you know, cheering us on every time. So
yeah. Well, yeah. All right. Well,
thank you for your candor, man. Really appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you. And once again, congratulations. We'll see you at the beginning of June for the LAN finals.
Thanks.
Thanks, buddy. All righty.
There you have it, man.
It's always fun to listen to his thoughts.
I know. Again, like, he is probably one of the most honest people that you'll just like meet for the first time, and then boom. Well, this is the first time I'm meeting him, basically. But you know, he just speaks his mind. Doesn't matter how it's super unfiltered, and he doesn't care how it sounds.
It's refreshing. But we will be seeing Reynad at that LAN finals at the beginning of June. And of course, that $25,000 prize pool for the LAN finals would not be possible And none of this would be possible without our wonderful sponsors, Plantronics and Gigabyte, have jumped on for Season 2. They're making a lot of this stuff possible. We have 4 more players to come from the Redemption Tournament, 8 more players to come from the Last Chance Qualifier. It's going to be a 16-player LAN. We have lots of fun things in store, a full weekend of Hearthstone action, and none of that would be possible without those guys. So one last time again, go ahead, check out those links that you just saw below the screen. You can head to legendaryseries.com, and also you can check out some products there. Help support us and support what we're doing.
Yep, and thanks for staying in the conversation. As always, at ESL Hearthstone, #HLS, and just be in the conversation with us. We love it. You love it. We'll go from there.
Yeah, and we're about to wrap up here, but Andre, do you have any final thoughts of the games you casted this weekend?
TJ, it's just been a lot of fun. I really like to watch the last series, obviously. It was just a lot of back and forth mind games, and most importantly, it was just a lot of drama to see just within the cards. Mm-hmm. So thankful for you guys to have me here. So thankful for you to be casting with me, man.
It was really fun. Really, really fun. And, of course, we will return at the end of this week, Thursday, May 14th, with the Redemption Tournament. But, again, congratulations, Reynad, for myself, from Andre, from everybody here at ESL. Thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you in a few days.